In your book, you start describing that you're a hustler. I didn't even know what that meant really by hustler, but a hustler means a guy who gets people to do what they want them to do.
A manipulator, a master manipulator.
Well, that's part of it. That's part of it. You know, hustler is anybody. Like, you can be a hustler. A hustler is anybody that gets up every single day and figures out a way to make good for themselves in this society. Hustler is anybody who has the drive to make something happen for himself. So happened for us, being in the street, hustling meant that we had to find a different way because there were no jobs available. You know, the school system was shot. Right. We had to hustle to find a different way to make means for ourselves.
And so, like people might not understand you being a crack dealer, but it seemed like in your neighborhood, this was some kind of hustle.
Well, anything without proper context, you can judge someone totally wrong. So if you given the circumstances that we were in, I'm not saying we were good or we made horrible decisions. We're 16 years old,
right?
14 years old. We're going to make bad decisions.
Right. Yeah, it's where's your guidance?
Our decisions are life and death. So we're given those proper context. You can see why a person could make such horrible decisions. I'm not saying to forgive us for a decision. Just understand the circumstances and not dismiss us as being just crack dealers.
So you at that point, you become a crack dealer. Are you a great crack dealer?
Incredible.
You were the best.
So, well, not the best, but I was really good.
What kind of money is a 14, 15-year-old kid making dealing crack?
For the most part, no money. You could make more money at McDonald's. At the end of the day, if you add up the hours and, you know.
Wasn't a good pay
scale.
It's
not a good job.
Right.
Not really. You're standing out there all day long.
You stood out there all day long. And you even say you avoided big prison time. You were in a car full of crack. The police had pulled you over, right? And then all of a sudden, they were going to bring in dogs to sniff out your car. But the dogs weren't available for some reason, and they had to let you go.
Yeah, that's the inspiration of 99 Problems, but a bitch ain't one.
Right.
It's you know, we were talking about a canine on that verse. If you listen to the second verse, it all deals with that. And it's even a deeper underlining meaning to that stop, because during that time, the state troopers were pulling people over for being black, driving while black.
Right.
But they were black guys and, you know, going up to, you know, southern states with a trunk full of trouble.
Right.
So when we stop and when we meet at this point, I'm getting pulled over, but I know I'm getting pulled over for nothing, but I know I'm in the wrong.
Yeah.
So now I'm having a conversation with the cop as if I'm the cleanest guy on Wall Street. And we're having this conversation. It's like this cat and mouse game.
Right.
You know, with a person that's used to getting away with it. Versus this person who know he's in the wrong but has these racial undertones. That's why there's this, you know, I was doing 55 into 54. It shows you that I was being pulled over for nothing. I mean, because obviously the speed limit is 55.
It is an incredible mind fuck when you realize that you're being pulled over because you're being racially profiled.
Right.
You didn't do anything wrong, but you in fact did do something
but
wrong.
But you know you're wrong.
Right.
I'm so in the wrong, but I'm speaking as if, you know,
well, you said it in your book, and this really hit home for me. You said being born black is like being born with the presumption of guilt.
Right.
Like you always look guilty of something.
Right.
Everyone thinks I've done something bad here, and I haven't. But meanwhile, you had done something bad.
Well, it makes you do bad things, right?
Right. Sure, because if everyone thinks I'm guilty anyway, why not go out and do something bad?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of weird that way.
Yeah.
You point out in your book, too, that rap, it's the first time you could actually, in your lifetime, see the whole thing develop. Like, you saw this whole, you know, it went from, like, a couple of goofy kind of guys rhyming all the way then into Run DMC. And then you went into, like, a, you know, different
Tupac
rap stars.
Tupac and Biggie.
And you saw the thing become a real art form and become a way of, like the telephone, telling people what's going on in your neighborhood. And then all of a sudden, white kids are relating to it. It's got to be mind-blowing. And so you start to make money and all that. That's a world you don't come from. When you go into those situations now and you're mixing it up with these wealthy people, do you find there are times you don't know what to do? You don't know the etiquette? You haven't been raised in that environment?
No, because I'm myself in any room I'm in.
You never embarrassed yourself?
No, of course not.
Right.
I felt like I came up in a situation or a time, you know, where I wasn't afforded certain opportunities. And if afforded opportunities, I could be Oprah. I could be Bill Gates. I could be Warren Buffett. I think the thing that separates us two is the opportunity. They had access to opportunities.
Absolutely.
That I didn't.